After the ball is over, after this game is done, after the die lot's finished, and you are short just one. Many a knitter has made a tearful and desperate call, pleading with their local yarn shop, go after that ball.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to the Pen, Hook, and Needles podcast, episode 449. Today is Saturday, April 10th, 2021, as we are recording. We want to welcome all new and returning viewers to the Foon in the Woman Cave. If you are new, we're glad that you found us. We hope you see something you like and that you will join us permanently, you know, just maybe. And then if you are returning, we are glad to have you with us again. If you are in the shadows, either new or returning, please feel free, if you desire, to hit the little subscribe button, and I think it's on your right, and then hit the little bell so you get notifications.
Gently press, according to Ellie Dashwood. Gently press.
Gently press. We are not.
She's a sweetheart.
She is, and we are not violent here.
Nope, so, no violence.
So yeah, do that. I used to think the button was red, but it's not red anymore.
Oh, did they change color?
I think it's white.
No, the subscribe one is still red.
I didn't think so. Or no, maybe it's because I'm subscribed to the chat.
Yeah, if you're subscribed, it's not red anymore.
So anyway, we'd love to have you there officially with us, so you get notifications and kind of bump us up in the YouTube channels. And if you want to take part in the alongs and all the fun stuff that we do, then you might want to consider joining our home group, which is at phnpodcast.freeforums.net. That's phnpodcast.freeforums.net. We'd love to have you there. We have a lot of things going on, alongs and camaraderie and all kinds of fun stuff over there. So we'd love to see you there. Did we introduce ourselves? No, we didn't.
I actually don't remember.
I am Marlisha, also known as Lady Furnico.
I'm Tali, also known as Franciscan Gypsy. Yes, we must have done it because we do it automatically, but because we do it automatically, I don't remember when we
I don't think we did it this time because I was thinking, okay, I have to remember to do this.
Oh, really?
All right, anyway.
Because if you say it, I automatically follow you, but I don't. It's not a thought process anymore.
How
it's
many
like,
projects do you have?
Let me pull up my show notes. Because that's one of the things I do in the morning with my morning tea is I edit my show notes and put the count on there. I have 10.
Oh, you gotta go first.
How many do you have?
7.
Okay. For a while, I didn't think I'd have very many, and then I picked up a few.
I picked up a couple. I think I had 4 or 5 when I talked to you on, like, Thursday.
You said you had 6.
I know. I was inching with mine, and the progress isn't that great, but oh well.
I did a lot of work on several, and then, like, nothing on others. Mm-hmm. Okay. So my turn for the tea first. So I had the Patreons have already seen this one, and I talked about this one last week when I got it, but I hadn't opened it yet because I was saving it for Easter. This is literary collection for Simpson and Vale. It is Beatrix Potter's Organic Herbal Tisane? I know I've been told many times how to pronounce this. Mm-hmm. Blend. And I always say Tisane because I'm stubborn, apparently.
Sounds right to me. Is there an I at the end?
It's an E at the end. I think in my head I put an accent mark on it.
Well, that would be Tisane.
Tisane, that's what I say.
You keep saying Tisane.
In my head it's Tisane.
Yeah.
So then this is caffeine-free, one of the few ones that actually says caffeine-free on it, so I guess all the other ones must have caffeine. Which reminds me, we should be due pretty soon for doing another Parks one.
Maybe after we're finished with the COVID shots.
Okay, that works. Probably a good idea. Mm-hmm. Okay, so this has organic green rubios, organic rose hips, natural flavor, whatever that might be, organic chamomile, organic spearmint, and organic lemongrass. After an adventure with Peter Rabbit, relax with a cup of this naturally flavored strawberry herbal tea, herbal blend. The fruit flavor adds a delightful sweetness that is sure to appeal to children, while the natural and organic blend keeps parents happy. So maybe natural flavors, it means natural strawberry flavor.
Don't know.
Since they don't actually have strawberry in there otherwise. And this is a good one. I like anything with chamomile in it just about, though. It is one of my favorite teas. Doesn't seem to make me too sleepy. But I don't react to...
This one tastes even better than the last time. I taste this a lot, the strawberry in this time.
I think also you had it after the strawberry cupcake last time. You haven't had your cupcake yet.
Yeah.
So, of course, the strawberry cupcake would completely overwhelm this.
Right. And so, what's the mug?
Oh, I'm sorry. This is my All I Want Is to Hug All the Bunnies mug.
So cute.
So, works with my Beatrix Potter.
Now,
this might become a favorite tea.
It's very good. I actually really do like that. This one... This is what's in my daughter's head mug. It looks like. This is what my
Yes.
Okay.
This is tea is in my head.
I wouldn't doubt it.
This well, is not what, that tea.
This is what my daughter's head looks like. It's an oboe. Okay. Now, and if you want to know, you can ask.
As she waves her hands dismissively.
Dismissively. I have in here, I had this with the Patreons last time. What I tried to do was I received this a while back, and I saved it for Easter, so I've been doing it on Easter week, and I finished it today. Easter Basket Blend Herbal Tea. So I've had it all this week, and this was a limited thing. I think they only have it, like, during the Easter season. Celebrate the little things. Green rubios, ginger, lemongrass, orange peel, mango pieces, apricot pieces, passion fruit.
Hang on.
I can't read without my glasses.
Plus mango essence, yeah. Calendula.
That's really small, so.
Yeah.
So.
I thought you were going to wear your glasses during this.
No, only to read things. I don't really read that much, so. I mean, I read off a computer, but that's big enough.
Mm. And I'm good because I know that I'm particularly fond of that tea.
Right, so I really like that.
It's very strong on the ginger, and it's funny, while I like ginger when I'm nauseous, I don't necessarily like drinking ginger in tea.
I don't find it overly strong.
I find it a bit overpowering. I feel like ginger...
Because I could taste the mint in there, too, so...
I kind of feel like ginger, like, overwhelms everything that it's attached to, at least in tea.
And this is the gluten-free, dairy-free strawberry cupcake that I made.
Yes, that overwhelms the strawberry tea if we had it at first.
It overwhelms everything.
It does.
And excuse me while I have a bite, because once I get started with this, I won't be able to have another bite for a while.
And like Mom said, it's from the Everything Gluten-Free, Dairy-Free Cookbook.
Mm-hmm.
Mm. This is not a paid promotion.
Mm-mm.
Although it is excellent.
I have it on my fingers, so excuse me.
No excuses.
Okay. Moving on.
I'm going to do the same thing, because I'm just rude.
Okay. All right, we're moving on to our longs. I do want to remind, I know who you are. You won the clear project bag, was a project bag with clear sides by Whimsy Stitches. For the Ready, Set, Go, Cal, you have a couple more weeks to get back with us so you know, so we can send this out to you. I need to know that you saw what you won, what it is you won, and your particular so I can send it out to you, okay? So I know who you are. Congratulations. Please get in touch with me as soon as you see this, okay?
My cupcake was trying to attack my sweater.
Mm-hmm. Now, the PHN Christmas All Year Long. Okay, this is our year-long Cal for this year. It runs January 1st of this year all the way through December 31st. And that means when you hit January 2nd, it's done. When you hit January 1st, it's done. But if the thread is still open, then you can kind of slide things in. But don't wait. Don't wait till the last minute, okay? Make sure you get those things because you worked hard on it. We want you to have all the chances you can get. All right, so the project's supposed to be knit, loom knit, or crocheted. Previous whips are allowed but must be worked on during the along. Chatter and pictures are all on the same thread and one whip per project per week, the FO whenever it's completed. We do have prizes. As you noticed, we already did our first quarter prizes for this. We do have three more quarters to go. Any FOs in Franciscan Gypsy's Designs patterns, my yarn or my one pattern, or Lollipop Girl yarns or Laura's pattern. Lollipop Girl is Laura Concert. Those are all eligible for two chances at a prize for the FO. And if you use a featured pattern with the featured yarn, then that gives you three chances at a prize for an FO. The hashtag is PHN Christmas All Year 2021. On Instagram. If the project uses 50 yards or less for the FO, please post with another FO of 50 yards or more, okay? Operation Christmas Child or any projects going toward Christmas donations is eligible for two chances at a prize as well for the finished objects. as are any things that are made in the colors, Christmas colors, what we've determined to be Christmas colors for this along.
And that is in the thread.
Yeah, that's in the thread. Okay, so you've got, do you need me to speed it up?
Oh, no, I just don't know why I said that.
Okay. You've got shades of red, blue, green, silver, gold, purple, and pink, along with white, okay?
I think I just want to share that if people didn't catch it, they didn't have to necessarily
rewind. Right, right. Well, I noticed you're doing this.
No, I've got a foot cramp.
Oh, okay.
And it's worse if I have the foot elevated. The only thing I can do is kind of bounce it and make it active and keep the blood flowing, because otherwise it's going to cramp like crazy.
So make those colors predominant, okay? We want to make sure everybody in the group gets involved with this, not just people who celebrate Christmas, okay? Because this is important that all of the PHN family can be involved. Yeah. All right, now, the prizes for the second quarter, we have some pink cotton yarn that's cloudborn that goes along with a little small pink bag, okay? And that's one prize. And then we have Plymouth yarn Galloway, 3 skeins with blue stripes. So that's the other prize. So those are the 2 prizes that will be for the second quarter, all right? Autism awareness is in full swing, and we're starting to see some really fun things. So this is
a good time for bookworms, because honestly, you can go super nuts with bookworms.
I absolutely loved it. I can't remember if it was Steph or Jonah Dyer who it was that wrote that her bookworm was rather adamant about the fact that it was not going to have glasses, and if she had feet, she would do a bunny stomp, which I assume she means
amazing.
A spoiled bunny stomp, which absolutely made my day. It was so funny.
Well, her bookworm had that corrective surgery for her eyes.
If she needed it, she might be perfect. She might be of the MPKC persuasion.
Well, we don't talk about MPKC because she's really sensitive over here, and she might scratch her eyes out.
Mm-hmm. Mm.
That's why we declawed her, actually.
Yes. Well, anyway, she I think she was born without claws.
You think she was born without claws?
Yes.
She was born a domestic cat?
A domestic cat, yes. She just bristled. You could just see that. So this is to keep in mind autism. So every once in a while, we'll do some kind of random facts about autism, but we've been doing this for so long that we're not going to go through the whole gamut.
And a lot of times we tend to combine when we're talking about autism developmental things, because actually it's developmental delays on top of the autism.
Right.
So it kind of combines together for us.
And a lot of things might be anecdotal.
Yes.
So it's just to keep in the forefront for the next 3 months, you know, autism and autistic spectrum disorders, and the awareness that, you know, it's important to treat them as other, you know, just as you would treat other people. You know,
right.
It's awareness, just like any other awareness.
Just to keep in mind that sometimes something might seem rude, but it's not actually intended to be. Some of my favorite things are, well, I have a couple anecdotes. One is the one where she was talking to Aunt Lucia about weight, and Aunt Lucia was saying that she needed to lose some, and then Davina said no, she's just fine the way that she was, and then Aunt Lucia said something about, do you want a couple of my pounds? Jokingly, Davina's like, no, I don't want to be fat. So things like that.
Yeah. Well, my favorite of hers is still the one where she stuck her tongue out at me. I said, are you sticking your tongue out at me? And she said, no, I'm just stretching my tongue.
Now, that one's more on the developmental delays one, where the other one is definitely a social one, where she doesn't necessarily realize she called someone.
Yeah, well, it shows the different areas. It shows how young she actually is developmentally.
Mm-hmm.
And the other one shows her
More on the autism side of things, where it's a social disconnect.
It's more of a kind of, not even an obliviousness, it's just...
Well, it's just an unrealization that how things might be taken socially.
Right, right.
I see people who get the cues that maybe they might miss autism, the... underlying social cues.
And my sister's pretty easygoing about stuff like that. She knows what Davina is, so it's like, okay.
Yeah.
She kind of laughed about it.
Every once in a while, we'll stop and say, hey, Davina, just so you know, I know what you're saying.
Yeah.
But if you say that to someone else, you're going to really hurt their feelings.
Right. Or make them mad or whatever.
Yeah, exactly. So it's a constant education and things like that. Mm-hmm. Now, if for someone who doesn't have developmental delays, they might be able to learn to mimic a little bit better.
Mm-hmm.
With the developmental delays, it's a little bit harder for her, I think.
And sometimes when she tries to mimic it, what she does might technically be, you can tell she's trying to do the right thing. Right. And it's not exactly the right thing. So it's just...
It's a very, it can be a very challenging thing. I was watching something. I actually have a series somewhere. I wish I could find it. It was a British guy who was really, his field was autism. And he was talking about the ways that sometimes you can't tell because sometimes the kids will learn to mimic mm-hmm. so well, mm-hmm. even though they don't necessarily get the cues, they observe the cues. And a lot of times he said you see this with girls mm-hmm. where they'll mimic the cues like super well and you won't even catch on.
Well, for a long time when Davina was young, before her age differential was so much greater than her mm-hmm. developmental, she was able to do that.
Oh, because I know, I didn't notice until, now granted that was also a smaller... I didn't have as much to compare to.
Well, and also you were young.
That's true, because I'm a couple years younger than Davina.
So you know, you just kind of think, okay, she's going to be able to do all this stuff. And well, not all of them can. And that's the thing, it's a spectrum.
Yeah.
So while you might, you know, the thing that sometimes you have to deal with is, well, so-and-so's on the spectrum, and they're living on their own doing this, why can't XYZ person? Well, because it's not the same.
Well, I think you see that with a lot of things, mm-hmm. you know. You see it with chronic illness, you see it, I mean, I think you probably even see it with people who have other things like a cancer. Well, so-and-so did this. Why can't mm-hmm. you? People always tend to compare to others. And it's just not fair. You got to take people where they're at.
Right. Okay, so moving on with this still.
I think you see that with mental health, too. Oh, I guess that's where autism falls under. So ignore me.
Autism, I mean, this awareness, Cal-Cal-Al, which is subtitled, subnamed, or whatever, subheaded, it's okay to be different. Mm-hmm. Okay? This goes April 1st. Through June 30th, and projects can be started any time but must be worked on and are finished between April 1st and June 30th to be eligible for the prizes. WIPs and FOs will be eligible for prizes, and the hashtag is hashtag PHNAA2021. Now, we are co-hosting this with Laura Constant, who's been doing this with us forever, okay? She always asks us to make sure, but if she wants to do it, she's doing it. Mm-hmm. It wouldn't be the same without her.
Yeah.
So she's our co-host, and I think she's doing it just as we have in the threads, where if you're not on Ravelry, you can do it on Facebook, or you can email her or whatever, and you can ask her if you're concerned about how to be eligible in her groups. The rules are basically the same, except that everything must be predominantly, and by predominantly I mean about 80 to 85% bright colored. Laura's might be higher. I know for a while she was doing like 90% mm-hmm. bright color. Way back when. So,
yeah, I have no idea what her rules are now.
Yeah. So, anything that's predominantly dull colored or not, you know, super bright colors like that will be moved to the show off thread, okay?
This would not count.
No, it's not bright enough, okay? This wouldn't count either.
Yeah.
It's got bright pinks in it, but it wouldn't count, okay? Let's see here.
And no one's going to say that my brown one counts.
I meant to pull the prizes and stuff, but I got up this morning and it was like treading water. I was like walking through water. I just could not get started.
I didn't want to get started this morning either.
I don't know if it's the weather or if I'm...
It did rain last night.
Yeah. Well, I also tend to, when I worry about something, I tend to get tired after the worry is done. Mm-hmm. And I was worried about Davina's COVID shot. So,
although she had a very good nursing
student. She did, and she did very well, but I still had the worry mm-hmm. prior. So yeah. I was, you know, I probably got tired. So anyway, the featured patterns and featured yarns are exactly the same as before, with the addition of 10 hours or less braided bright, which is the Cal pattern he developed for us right at the beginning of our autism awareness.
Yeah, so like way back when.
Right. And the Autism Awareness Bear and Weighted Lap Pad by A Modest Creation, formerly Miss World. Mm-hmm. And that can be found on Etsy and I believe on Ravelry
as well. It is on Ravelry okay? as well. But if you're not on Ravelry, Etsy. Because Ravelry yeah. doesn't let you purchase yeah. anymore if you're not a Ravelry person.
And you can do any project you like. You just won't get the multiple chances unless you use the featured yarn or featured pattern.
Yeah.
Okay? And it has to be, you know, knit, loom knit, or crocheted, obviously. The prizes our first prize that we have that we've actually pulled, actually we didn't have to pull it, was donated to us. Mm-hmm. We have another lovely donation by Looney Hiker, who is Pat. Thank you very much, Pat. She's the one who donated the... I think it was called the Cassie Nicole hat. Mm-hmm. But this time, she's donating any one of her patterns to a winner for the Autism Awareness Cal-Cal, okay? It would be the winner's choice of one of her patterns, and you would contact her for that, okay? And I think that's an amazing... Mm-hmm. She has a really nice shawl that I think I purchased because it's really beautiful. Now, the comfort along is not our baby. The comfort along is Patty, who is Wombat of Doom, and B-Wing, who's Brittany, okay? And we do have a thread for this, and the prizes will be pulled from that thread, not the Facebook page where you can also put your pictures and things.
That's just for sharing.
Yeah. This runs from March 1st through June 30th, just like our autism awareness. No previous whips are allowed for this one, okay? Items eligible for this comfort along can be knitted, crocheted, or loom knit. And I'm reading this because they're not. This is not our rules, yeah. Okay? They're using
Isn't
us as a platform.
Isn't it knit versus knitted? Is knitted a verb? Or is it knits the...
Well, you can say knitted, but it's loom knit, not loom knitted. It is knitted.
And you say, I knit something. You don't say, I knitted something. I think usually knit is... No, even then you say, he knit me in my mother's womb.
It's a to-be construction. Comfort can be knitted. Crochet.
Okay, yeah, but you wouldn't say... Just knit past tense.
Okay. Yeah. I mean, some people do say I knitted this, but...
But I don't... I don't think that's most
it
correct.
It might be archaic.
It's a chain, like, a natural... Like,
evolution.
The language might be... Thank evolution. You. Brain wasn't working.
Okay. Specific items that they're looking for are dishcloths, washcloths, and hats. Hat sizes can be from young child through adult, and there's a greater need for boys' colors or gender neutral, so please keep that in mind. Not to say you can't do females, because if you don't, then there'll be a lack of females, right? patterns like the Fits the Whole Fam hat by Cozy Up Knits are perfect since they are so stretchy and are suitable for many sizes. Chatter and pictures all on the same thread, one whip per project per week, the FO whenever it's completed. If you are also in Comforting Crafts Facebook group, feel free to post your pictures there. Prizes will be randomly generated through the PHN's normal method from the Comfort Along thread. All right? Apparently, the prizes right now are two skeins of dishy yarn, dishcloth pattern booklets, handmade greeting cards by B-Wing, and, like I said, I may donate something or Ty may donate something or whatever.
I was thinking maybe one of the Tortoise versus Hare pattern books.
Yeah, and I was thinking a skein of yarn. So... that might be something as well. So the hashtag for Instagram will be hashtag PHN Comfort Along 2021. And you guys will just have to wait and see if we do it.
Yes.
It'll be a surprise. All right. Please contact Brittany for the mailing address for the completed items. We don't want to put her address out on the web. Okay. All right. That takes care of that.
Okie dokie then. So that means I start. Now don't get too settled knitting on something because these are two designs. So it's just going to be bags.
I want to have my cupcake.
So in my Silver Shed USA, what's going on with that? Sorry. Oh, okay, they're just live. Five Dinners 1 Hour is live on Facebook. They notify me when that happens. What they do is they will cook with a couple of recipes, but sometimes they'll give tips like how to make things go a little smoother, maybe how to save energy. And sometimes it's nice to have in the background. It's mm-hmm. gentle. Kind of like mm-hmm. listening to Kay.
Mm-hmm. I love listening to Kay. She makes me happy.
The lady last night, I didn't get to catch the whole thing because something happened with my internet briefly. And then she ended up skipping to next recipe when I was able to get back on. But you know when you open those jars of like, it's the... like the Pillsbury biscuits or something and it pops?
Yeah, I love those.
Hers popped and it like shot something at the screen.
I've never had that happen.
She says it like she knew what happened. She was lying. She was dropping things all over the place. She was just going to be one of those days for
those days when it's going to happen. It's going to happen.
And
now.
It's going to happen while she's live.
Yep. So that used to go pop like that, you know.
Yeah, you know, and that's probably the best thing she did is just like what they tell you to, which is twist it. I never
do it that way. I either do that or I'll stick a spoon in there. And
you know. I think you taught me to do it that way, so I didn't get the surprise pop.
It always pops, but...
But not like the explosive, I'm going to shoot something at you pop. Anyway, so, obviously I'm not catching this live. I'll catch another one later. They do enough of them. So, this is in my Silver Shed USA Peanuts Christmas bag. And it says Christmas stocking pattern for Davina. I need to get cracking on this because she wants it for Christmas. So...
And we're already... Going in, what, our fourth month now? April? January, February, March, April. Fourth month of the year. That is just weird.
Yeah. I mean, I have enough time to finish it. I finished two stockings last year. Mm-hmm. But I also am not as solely focused on designs this year as I was last year. I just can't keep up that energy. I want to work on other things as well. And also, I have more than the rosaries have been, like, mm-hmm. I had to focus on that too while still having time to rest and relax. So I'm pacing these out a little bit more, which I'm sure my testers are a little bit relieved about. Okay, then in my knitting's my bag, adorable little finch.
No, yeah. Chickadee.
Chickadee. Darn it. Chickadee bag. They're cute. I always want to hold one in my hand. Mm-hmm. It always looks like one of those birds like a Disney princess mm-hmm. has go into her hand. Small like enough, Belle.
Yeah. Like Sparrow or something.
The ones that, you know, she had to convince to come to Beast because when he crouched down, they didn't want to come to him until she kind of led them that way. The smile on his face when they actually did climb into his hand. For a cartoon, they really managed to get the feel, and that was such a cute scene. Anyway, design in here. Bookmark design.
For a long time, that was my favorite one until Rapunzel came along. Mm-hmm. And then they kind of, I was like, which one's your favorite? Like, I'm like, don't ask me that question. Yeah. Okay, mine.
The one that kind of surprised me is I actually really like Moana.
Yeah, I have to revisit that one.
Well, because you didn't actually get a chance to watch it, I don't think.
I watched it.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Because it's...
I just wasn't that impressed.
It helps I really like the music.
Yeah.
Now,
the one I think I'm going to like, and I think I actually did like, surprised me, was Mulan.
Yeah, Mulan is good. It is a good story. Yeah. It's actually based on an actual legend.
Yes.
And with all legends, they have multiple tellings. Mm-hmm.
I'm trying to find my bag here. Which bag do I need to look for? My Pluverbird Mickey Mouse bag. Okay. It's this one. This is my spoiled bunny stomp scarf. So maybe this is the scarf that needs to go to that little bookworm.
Because bookworms need scarves for their shoulders.
It's doing a spoiled bunny stomp because he doesn't want glasses. So maybe what it really wants is a scarf.
Maybe.
Okay.
It would look dashing in its scarf.
Dashing. Or fashionable if it's female. I forget what the name was, so I don't know if it's male or female. Mm. And this is Test Designer Yarns, and I'm using an eye hook. I had to pick up that hook for you know who. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I've done some work on this. Usually, like I said, I do it during the podcast, so I have at least one thing to show you guys when we do this episodes.
Indeed. I guess it goes on to moi.
It does.
So, in my... Let me pull up my notes so I can do things in somewhat of an order. Well, that's interesting. They have two people prepping together. That's either going to be really good or an absolute mess. That. No, I'm not. I just saw the notification. You know, because I can see that when you have two people in the kitchen, it can either work really well, or it could be them constantly tripping over each other.
Well, I think if you're doing it like something like that, you're probably used to doing it together, and you have that's a sonnet down, you know.
That's true. Okay, so this one I actually was surprised. I had a lot of fatigue this week, so I really wanted to work on things that were simple. Mm-hmm. So, in my... Oh, gosh, I don't remember who made this bag. I don't think it has a tag on it.
Oh, yeah. I remember.
This is one of
my... That's not Papaloo, is it?
Yes. Good job, Mom. Because I don't think she put her tag in here. And I only ordered two... Oh, yeah, here it is. Papaloo. For a while there, I picked up two bags from her because she would custom them. She made me a Nightwing bag, which is somewhere in my bag box. And she made me this one, which I consider my blanket bag. This is my Batgirl one. Originally, she had it like this with, the one she had listed had all, had Supergirl, Wonder Woman, and Batgirl. I was like, well, can I just have Batgirl? Mm-hmm. So she made me just a Batgirl one. And it's Barbara Gordon, which is best. Even though I have to admit, Oracle is where she really comes into her own.
Yes. But I usually have the stuff with Oracle. They're usually just, you know.
Yeah.
Cartoon type things will have just back roll.
So I actually was surprised I would do work on this, like I said, and worked quite a bit on this because this is mindless and it would have bright colors.
Mm-hmm. Well, that would go for autism awareness.
Yes, it would.
As would this.
Yes. So this is Kate's fault blanket, my square blanket. I started this an eon ago. This was before she even wrote her pattern that she had the miter square blanket. Like she does it now with where you have the miter squares and you have a border and then you connect them all. this was when it was just a recipe on the Patreon. That's what I started when I started this. So this has been going on forever. This is actually a bed, like it's a bed cover size. So it'll be worked on for a while. And also the squares are a lot smaller than my other one. But I worked on quite a few squares because it was mindless.
And I love Kay's tutorials and stuff because I actually started the My Order Squares. I've started them multiple times, but I started the first time when it was still just a tutorial.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So I worked 1, 2, 3.
There's a lot.
4, 5.
1, 2, 3, 6, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 7, 8. Counting.
9, 10 of these.
Wow.
And.
Or the week?
Okay,
that's a lot.
Because I actually think I did start on Easter Sunday. And what I've been doing as well is that this time around, I've been weaving in the ends as I go.
Good idea.
Because I actually have also been weaving in the ends of the Afghan version that I finished. I've been trying to weave in, you know, a couple squares a day. So I'm probably getting fairly close-ish.
That's kind of mindless for you.
It is. It's, and I've gotten to the point where it's like, okay, if I tell myself, like I do it right before bed or right when I get up in the morning, right. I get a few squares with the ends woven in. So then it's not like I'm spending a long period of time just doing weaving in the ends.
Right.
And for this, if I make myself weave in the ends before I continue, then it's okay. Uh-huh. I mean, I still have the ones before. Although, I did about half of them where I wove in the ends as I went. And then I got lazy and I did like 3 rows where I didn't. Mm-hmm. But at least when I'm done, I'll only have 3 rows worth to weave in the ends.
Right. Versus if you continue.
If I continue. Because from the beginning, I was weaving in as I went. Now, the other one, did I edge the other one? I think I edged the other one. I'm not sure I'm going to edge this one. I think I might just leave it be.
Mm-hmm.
It's too big to edge. And then if I ever decide I want to add more squares, I can always do so.
Edging never stopped you from adding squares.
No, but then it looks stupid.
You just have to tink back or whatever.
But, yes. So, this has gotten quite a bit of work, as you can see. Actually, let me move my little marker so I know that I already showed this. Because that's why this marker's here, so I know how many squares I worked. And this is going to be a very long-term project. I mean, as you can see, it's nowhere near. I mean, right now it's a runner. A bed runner.
Mm-hmm. I'm not sure what a bed runner is for. I guess
it's just
fashion or
pretty. Or maybe if your feet get cold.
Yeah, I guess.
But you don't want to have a full covering.
Yeah.
I don't know. But right now it's kind of like that.
Mm-hmm. You have one more?
Oh, hold on me. How many will that bring you to if I do one more?
Well, you had 10 and I have 7.
Okay, so I do how many twice?
2 or 3.
Because
2 would make you have 6 left. Yeah, I think you can. I think this is the last time you have to do double, and if you do, you can do it at the end.
Okay.
I think that's right. I can't math right now.
We'll do that, and then if I have to at the end.
Yeah.
Okay, so then the other one, let me bring up my show notes. I'm very waffly today.
I warned him ahead of time that I'm not going to be able to focus. So.
Okay, so this seems to be my time of pulling out some of my older projects. I think I did a lot of that on Easter. I just wanted to work on something different on Easter. Mm-hmm. I want bright, and I wanted different.
Mm-hmm.
So I pulled that out on Easter and started, and I pulled this out. In my Silver Shed USA Tree Frogs bag is my Buttercups and Bluebells Field, and it's the On the Forest Floor by Simone Kurit. Now, I'm getting fairly close to where the pattern is supposed to end, yet I have also written myself instructions to lengthen it.
Mm-hmm.
And to also take out those
little twigs.
Well, you don't have to write it in to take out the twigs.
Oh, this?
I'm taking out this here because inevitably I catch these ginormous eyelets on doorknobs. I catch it on my rollator.
It's nothing to do with the pattern.
It's everything to do with me.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't know how many times I've yanked this off of myself because this catches on things.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm leaving it out of this one and I'm making it a bit longer. So,
it shouldn't be difficult. You shouldn't even have to write anything, really. Just keep knitting.
No, you do have to write a little because I want to keep it in pattern.
Right.
I don't want to just make one color keep going. I have to keep it in pattern.
Oh,
say,
I see what you're saying. Yeah.
And I think I add another increase row.
Mm-hmm.
One more increase row. So
that makes sense.
Yeah. there we go. And I look forward to having this. It's bright, it's happy, and it matches a hat that I've knit, which was the whole reason why I did these colors. Because I didn't have anything that matched that hat.
And Davina would be so proud of you for being fashionable and matching. I'm a typical knitter. I don't care. I will wear what I wear.
Well, I do kind of.
I do like to match. But.
And I have a yellow shawl that I do wear with it. Mm-hmm. But.
I mean, I don't like going around. Like, I wouldn't wear this kind of a hat and this with mm-hmm. this. I mean, that would look stupid.
Because normally I wouldn't wear this green of Dragon's Flight. Mm-hmm. But combined with the yellow and the dark blue, I really like that combination. Mm-hmm. Normally, this green would be too light for me.
You know, these colors I have in here are the same family. It's just that, you know, the blue is darker, but, yeah. you know, it's the same kind of thing, except for the yellow. I've got the orange, the green, and the blue. Here's the
gold. Yeah. See, I would call that yellow. I guess it is orange.
There's yellow right there in this gold here. So,
yeah.
Lost my shoulders.
It was good to work on this again. The rows are very long. Mm-hmm. So, you know, you work one row and you're like, okay, I need a break.
I was reading something. Somebody had a shawl that they were doing. I think it was called like Scraps Fari's Shawl or something like that. I'm not sure exactly. And they were talking about how you cast on 500 stitches. I said, I'm not ever making that. Not ever.
No, if I'm going to work a shawl, it's going to be from the top mm-hmm. down. So that way I can make it as long as I want. Mm-hmm. I can make it as wide as I want. And I'm not casting on 20 million.
I don't have to cast on 500 stitches. Oh my gosh, no way. And like you said, you get to determine how long you want it.
Well, like for this one, you know, I determined I wanted it a lot longer, mm-hmm. or a bit longer.
Well, look with my, on the crochet end, look how long I made the scrap shawl because mm-hmm. It was, you know, from the top down and I could just, you know, keep going.
Yeah.
You know, just follow the pattern and keep going and you have a bigger shawl or a smaller.
Although if you have that big of a chain, you almost want to go foundation single crochet because that, like a 500 chain cast on, for lack of a better term,
well, I don't care.
Would be ridiculous.
My point is, regardless of the single crochet, I will still twist something like that long. I just don't like that long a start. I prefer, and you don't have the option to make it as long as you want.
Mm-hmm. No, you don't.
So that was my point.
I know it is. I was just thinking out loud to myself.
Yeah. So let me just finish the stitch, because that was your second one, right?
Yes, it was. Actually, I need to throw it over there.
Let me just
finish. I know I talked about it.
This stitch here, because it's multiple stitches within the stitch. There we go. Okay, let's see. That's done.
I can really taste the strawberry this time around.
Yeah.
I'm trying to do what it tells me to do, which is basically, you know, it says to do a, it doesn't tell me, but what it says is meant for 6 ounces of water. And since I have 16 ounces there, mm-hmm. I don't want to do two flat mm-hmm. teaspoons. So I've been really heaping them it. And that's been helping a lot.
I actually did a bit of a heaping teaspoon on this one this time around because uh-huh. I only had like a tad left,
uh-huh.
and it actually made it a lot better. So I think this is a weaker tea that needs a little more.
I tend to do heaping teaspoons anyway, just because I like more flavor.
Okay, this one you haven't seen in a while. This was what I was going to make a pattern on this. Now I'm not so sure. Now I'm just going to play with it, and whatever way I stitch it, I stitch it, and it's going to, because you can't really see it anyway. It's dark yarn. This is my On the Garden Path scarf project.
I'd forgotten all about that project.
Yeah, so. It's the color does it all. You know, this, you can't see the pattern, so I'm just going to, you know, knit, and it might even be like a kind of thing where you say, okay, I'm going to do this, or I'm going to do that.
Yeah.
And you just kind of mix it up, and it's not going to be a pattern, it's just going to be
fun,
and it's going to be mindless for me, and I can give it to charity. Uh-huh. I think they'll like, a man will like this, it's, or maybe even a woman will like this, I don't know. I wouldn't mind it. And because it's so dark, you can't see the pattern, so it's a wasted effort to.
Yeah, you don't want to go too much effort with that color.
So I'm just going to, you know, do that. And then when I can see it better in a different yarn, maybe I'll think about working up a pattern.
Yeah.
But this one, I don't want to stop because I like the way it's working up.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm using James C. Brett in a bulky color. A bulky yarn.
Bulky color. How does a bulky color work?
I don't know. You have to ask it. Okay.
Okay, so.
There's a Silver Shed USA Star Wars bag.
In my, oops, wrong bag. This one. in my knockoff designer bag is Luz, L-U-Z, which is, she's from my Cyrano, the bookworm pattern that I've designed, and I'm using Miss Babs Yowza. And she got a little bit of work. Not sure how much. I don't think it was terribly much. A little bit one evening when I didn't really want to focus, I think.
I haven't wanted to do toys lately.
Well, I know that I need her to block lights. Mm-hmm. She's not just a toy for me.
I mean, I love doing toys. I just haven't felt like doing them right now. Yeah. Because I don't want to do the faces right now.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter if they have eyes like that, which I prefer, or eyes that I have to put in. I just don't want to do them.
You don't feel like it.
So all my toys are languishing right now.
So yeah, I know that I need to finish her because I have another one that's on the hooks waiting for me to finish her. Candy's waiting. And once I finish the two of them, Mom can get her bookworm back.
Poor bookworm.
Because right now he's blocking the light on my other one.
He's all misshapen because Ty mistreats him.
Well, he doesn't quite fit where I need to put him, but he's still the toy that fits best there. Luz will fit better.
My poor Pippin, the platypus. Not Ty's platypus, one of Stacy Trock's. Doesn't know why he got relegated to...
Why he's getting kicked?
Yeah, kicked around. I mean, it's not like mean kicked around. It's just like you move out of the way of the door and stuff like that. And
he feels abused. He thought he was in happy retirement, and he gets kicked and
put on the top of the dirty pile. And
he doesn't like his new life. He wishes the bookworm come back because the bookworm didn't know any better.
Yep. Let me just finish this row here, and I'll get to the next one. Projects that I work on. Yay! Because I'm trying to make really good use of my time. It's really hard to juggle all my stuff. I guess I should let go of something, but I really don't want to. Or maybe do a day for this and a day for that. I don't know.
That's all right, though.
Yeah.
Because what if you don't feel like doing it that
day? Exactly. What if I don't want to do that day? Okay, let me just... I got this done. I think I'm missing a needle minder. Because this is too big to have just one.
Yeah.
Okay. My next one is in my Cloverbird pink and purple teacups bag. This is my scrap shawl pattern. Comfy, cozy shawl pattern from the scrap shawl shawl by Anastasia Zettel.
So not Mom's pattern.
Not my pattern. I don't have a shawl pattern that's crocheted yet. Okay. So.
Hashtag life goals. Yes.
Let's see here. So I've made a little progress on this. This is another one that if I sit down and do it, it goes pretty quickly. This bag is just full of yarn. Okay. So I've done a little bit on this. All tangled up here. I'm not sure why I'm still connected to something here. I think it comes from being in too small a bag. Okay, this one. Sorry, guys. I can't show it to you until I get untangled. And it's just not wanting to cooperate here. Oh, I see the problem. You would think with all my yarn stuff that I do, the dyeing yarn and stuff like that, I'd be a little better at getting them untangled, but
okay. It happens.
Yeah. All right. Okay. I have to cut this one.
Well, that's unfortunate.
No. To so it doesn't keep tangling because I'm doing a different color.
Oh, okay.
Maybe I'm carrying it up the side. I haven't decided yet because this is the first row. So this is what it's looking like. You can see that I've got I've started the second part of the stripe on the other side of the blue. Can you see that? Oh, I should. Okay. Here you go. See? You can see on the side here.
Yeah, I think they can see.
I'm kind of challenged. I can't see.
They can see.
Okay. Right here, I have to finish the side for this color. Okay. And I'm using a lot of Miss Babs. I think I've got some dragonfly fiber in here. And I'm kind of interested in doing some of the larger projects if I can pull together more than one skein of yarn to use some of the yarn that had been just sitting there on my shelf that I like, but I didn't know what to do with. So I'm making things. And this one I really wanted to have because I don't have, I have one of these shawls, but not in a, in the colors I really favor, which is this, these colors.
Mm-hmm.
And I needed something that, you know, I could wear more often and a little bit bigger than the one I have.
Right.
So
that's isn't the one you have also very heavy?
It's the same yarn, but I think maybe I used a smaller hook.
Oh, I thought the one you had was a Caron Simply Soft. Because it was kind of that shiny.
Oh, okay. I'm thinking of yours for some reason. I'm thinking of yours, which I made similar colors Kay's shawl, not one of mine. So you're right. It was Caron. So this is a little bit lighter because that's Caron Simply Soft is almost like an Aran weight.
Yeah.
So it is heavier. This one will be a little lighter for me, which I
yeah. Like I remember you saying that. The only reason I remember is because you kept saying that that's why you didn't wear it.
Mm-hmm. I wear it mostly in the dead of winter. I'll wear it if we go out, and we don't go out. It sits in my my drawer.
Mm-hmm.
So yes, that's it.
All right, finish this last stitch. There we go. Okay, in my, okay, where are you? Oh, it ran away. There we go. In my Silver Shed USA, oops, is a bunny bag. You didn't drink.
I don't know if I have anything left to drink.
Well,
I do have some.
Mom's Sunday Funnies House Socks. This is the Dance All Night Socks pattern, and I'm using Miss Babs in the Funny Papers colorway. So, first sock has been done for a very long time.
Very nice.
Eons, even.
Really?
No, it's been finished like earlier this year.
You fibbed.
Eons relative to finishing other things, maybe. Mm. Except I really do have projects that have been on the needles for years. So
do I. So do I. They're just sitting there.
Okay, so although I did get rid of a lot of the ones that have been on the needles for years that are not big projects.
Mm-hmm. Well, between the Ready, Set, Go, where we got rid of a lot of stuff and then finishing a few things, I did cut down, but then I
added things.
Yeah,
same here. So heel flap is done. I need to start the heel turn.
Yay.
And this is my preferred type of heel. I've done other types of heels, like the wrap and turn. I've done the afterthought, but this is my favorite one to knit and my favorite one to wear. I like the way it feels. And like I said, more fun to knit. Let me pull this up here. So yeah, once I do that, I can then go on and finish the sock. Go on to gusset and all that. Sorry, brain's hard.
Brain's hard?
Brain's hard.
You mean thinking's hard?
That too.
Okay. How you feel?
Tired.
You're a little red, so. Not a lot, but a little.
Well, it's just like all of a sudden I got slammed with fatigue.
Okay. The next one is in my Kickapoo Owls bag, and I didn't do a whole lot of work, but I did some. This is the preemie hat, and it's the Hobby Lobby, I Love This Cotton in the Sea Spray Stripes colorway. And the Cindy Wood Loom, Laura Concert gave me a while back. So this, I know it's very simple and I know I should move on, but this is truly one of those things where I sit there and I can just do it.
Mm-hmm.
And if I have to tear it out, it's not a big deal because it's small and I can start it over again. So this is really kind of a comfort thing for me.
It's not as much an investment in the FO as it
sleeve.
Is in... I guess so, yeah. You would have to increase at one point.
Why?
It stretches. Because
it stretches. Anyway, it's a hat. Not a sleeve. It's a hat.
Okay, so next is me. Oh, it's this one. Let me tink back so you can actually see a flap this time instead of last time when I was in the middle of a round.
All right.
So this is my Lake of Shining Waters. It is the Ann sweater by Joanna Johnson. It's from her Green Gables Knits. And this is my second time that I've cast on this sweater. The first time was with the black alpaca yarn with red sparkles. And I didn't quite get gauge or...
I think you said the yarn was not
And
right.
The yarn was not... Well, it's DK, but it must have been a slightly different...
I think it was thinner.
So it was either... I think the yarn might have been thinner. And also, I might have lost track of where I was and knit part of the wrong size. I've been very careful to make sure I'm paying attention this time around. It looks like it'll fit this time. I'll know better, of course, once I get the armholes, which is actually after this row, I'll be separating for the arms. But it looks like it would be big enough. It doesn't look like last time. Mm-hmm. 'Cause... trying to find the seams. So, yeah, that looks about right. And it doesn't even have the border, the band, the button band thing. Even though there's no buttons, they still call it button band, I guess. And it doesn't have the button band ribbing thing either, which will also make it even wider. So, I think I've got where I want it this time. This yarn is nice and soft. This is also alpaca, although I think the other one was not baby alpaca. This one's baby alpaca. Apparently, I knit this sweater in alpaca, and that's it. Although, I will definitely knit these kinds of sweaters in baby alpaca again. Knit Picks has a good price for their baby alpaca. And the colors are really nice. And it's a really soft yarn. Mm-hmm. But I would probably not necessarily choose it for something with buttons. Mostly the things that are just open and just kind of swingy.
Right.
I don't know why I put that on there because I'm still knitting this.
I like those kind of sweaters that are... One of my favorite sweaters is like that with the... I haven't worn it in a while.
Yeah, you haven't. That's odd.
Yeah. Well, we haven't done anything really gone out or anything like that, so...
What? That changes things how?
Well, I wear different things in the house sometimes.
Your turn.
Okay, I'm just trying to see if I need to... I have to make sure what I'm doing here and then I can move on here. Just like that. Just give me a second. It's the only part of the shawl that I have to pay attention on, really.
And of course, that's when I always end, is when you have to pay attention.
Yep. So, just...
I'll probably have to pick a different project to work on once I actually have to separate for the sleeve, simply because I don't know that that would be the best... I don't know that I have something to hold my stitches.
Right. Okay, let me put this one away.
Right on hand.
Move on. I'm wondering if I put my other needle minder in maybe another project bag.
You possibly could have.
Because I have been known to do that.
Well, I know I have a random tape measure on my desk that I'm not sure which project it came from.
Done that too.
So I was measuring something, and I have no idea where that came from.
Okay, so this bag is going to go over here so I can get to other things. All right, my next project is the bag and wrap project from the Burl Wrap pattern by KF Jones. And I moved this out of the Firefly bag, which was a little small for it, to the bag that Mama C, who's Christina, so generously gifted me. She made it for me. It's a large owl's bag because I don't have enough owls. Love it. Absolutely love it. And I did make some progress on this, and I think I am in the middle of a row. So this is a lot of this is Dragonfly Fibers yarn, as well as maybe some Miss Babs. So the Chalgu Red Lace Circulars and US 7. So that's that.
Okay, so I need to work on Dad's sweater again. I think because I'm very close to the point where I know I might be at the end of my 17 inches. Mm-hmm. I don't want to be working it if I can't measure it.
Right.
So it's like that point where I'm like not working on it when I probably should.
Why do I have this?
So in my Mama C, hang on, I feel like I skipped something. Oh, I did. In my Silver Shed USA PHM Faces bag is a colorwork tunic for me. It's a tunic with Valdres pattern from Hand Knits from Norway by Karen Marie Vinhe. So this only got a little bit of work. It's another one where I don't, you know, I have to work on it when I'm sure I can measure. Although there's a lot less to measure here. I only need to measure like an inch and a half before I do my next increase or decrease or whatever.
Right.
This is one that once I finish my increase, decrease, rows, whatever, then I'm knitting for a long time until I get to the color work.
Right.
And then it'll go back to being a mindless. And this is shepherd's wool, so it's nice on the hands. Yeah, you kind of want to pet it.
It's one of the few non-superwash that I like.
I want to say this is like frosted something or other. Frosty blue. So. This, what's the name of the realm for the frost giants? Is that not something high?
I had it. I just had it.
Jotunheim?
I had it.
I feel like
it.
It's with a Y.
Jotunheim? I forget.
Jotunheim. It's Jotunheim. I'm pretty sure it's Jotunheim. So, for some reason, that makes me think of this.
Yeah. I mean, it's a mean sweater.
It's just a frosty blue sweater.
It's a frosty blue sweater. It's cold. It's cold out there.
Oh, my zipper's on this side.
Okay, let me see here.
I'm pretty sure it's Jotunheim.
Sounds right. Good okay. Job. I didn't get a whole lot done in this one. I think I did. Well, actually, I think I did 2 or 3 rows on this. So I guess I did that more than I thought. This is in my Monet Serap bag. It's a stormy weather sweater from the Fundamental Woman's Pullover. I'm still in the ribbing, but I have like just the last bit of ribbing to do before I go into the actual sweater. So,
well, then you get to just knit for a while.
Just knit for a while. So here it is. I do like this color, and every time I look at it, I'm struck with how much lavender underlay there is mm-hmm. for this gray. So you can see the ribbing has grown. It's not a huge ribbing, but it's enough, and I'm enjoying working on it. And I'll just sit down and do the rest of it maybe later on today or tomorrow or something, so I can get started on the actual sweater body.
Right. And feel all accomplished and stuff. Okay, so now in my Mama C.
Why is my yarn shedding?
I don't know. Mama C. Tudor bag. This is, and I need to reach over to grab something, my, almost knocked over the light, the test I was doing, which is the, Beatrix Bunny socks. I don't think that's released yet. It's by Yarn Love Yarn, and...
But you finished the testing.
Well, yeah, I finished the test itself, so I finished the first sock, which is all I was required to do. I have it on a blocker simply because when it's not on the blocker, it looks like it won't fit me, but it does. it's just because it's not as ribbed as I'm used to it being, so it looks like it's too big for my foot. Mm-hmm. But it fits nicely, which is nice. I like with the bigger version that I feel you can see the bunnies better. So I'm happy with that. And I started, and I actually did for Patreons, a tutorial for casting on for magic looping.
Yay!
So I'm still editing that just to make sure that it makes some sense, and then I'll put that up when I put that up. So that's, I have a little bit of the ribbing done, probably about halfway there, and then I will start in the color work. And I am using these are Knit Pro Zings. It's Zings, whatever.
Knit Pro Zings.
Yeah, Knit Pro Zings. And this is the 2. I love the... I actually prefer for magic looping to use Knit Pros mm-hmm. because the cable's a little bit more flexible than the Chow Goose. Mm-hmm. I prefer the Chow Goose for everything else, but I prefer the cable for magic looping for the Knit Pro Zings. Just a personal preference. And not to mention... I like having, a lot of times if I'm magic looping, I'm working some sort of project where I will probably have to change a needle size somewhere in there. So having 2 different colored
right.
needles to work with is nice. So okay. There be that.
All right, my next one, I think this might be my last one actually, is a little peach scrubby. From the round dish scrubby pattern. Now this one I started last week, I believe, and I didn't like it, so I took it out. I pulled it out.
That's what I remember you saying on the podcast you didn't like how it was going.
So I pulled it out and I restarted it. And this is where I'm at. Right here. So it's going along. And I think even though she does the extra chains at a certain point, I think I'm going to not do that. Because I like the way when I didn't read the pattern properly. Uh-huh. I like it better without that. So that's what I'm probably going to do. But this is fun. It's pretty mindless. And it can be for for little dishcloth scrubby kind of things, maybe for Brittany or something. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, that takes care of that. And this is another Silver Shed USA bag because we love Anne.
Yes.
Okay.
My final project was in a different bag, but it moved to my Mama C Bunnies bag. This is my hot stuff. So the pattern is Walking to Town. It's from the Emma Knits book by Joanna Johnson. And it's only available as an ebook right now. It's available on Ravelry and on Etsy. And I'm using the Knit Pros because that's what I have.
Ooh.
What?
Now I know what I want to do. I have yarn. What's the weight on that?
This is a DK.
I wonder if I have enough of that one yarn that I picked up several skeins. It's got a little sparkle to it. It's kind of a brown.
Oh, nice. That would be pretty, Mom.
Yeah.
And if you don't have enough, if you're able to do like a yellow on that.
I don't like
or a different color down at the bottom.
Yeah.
You can do a different kind of brown. You could do a yellow, a pink.
The brown that I've got, I could even do maybe kind of almost a purpley kind of brown.
Yeah, if you had to do anything anywhere, if you didn't have quite enough, I would say down at that lace.
Well, I even thought if I could almost do the ridges.
Yeah, I'm not sure if that would take away from it or not.
I don't know. I think it depends on the color.
Yeah, so there this is. And I like the way that when you do the lace area where it ruffles around the arms to kind of create a sleeve effect. So for me, it kind of saves the shawl from what I usually find is this fate of triangle shawls is that they don't cover enough the arm. Mm-hmm. This seems like it'll cover more of the arm. And it uses what I have left of Dragonfly fibers in the Airport Hot Sauce colorway.
How much yarn do you need for that? How much yardage?
Oh, I wrote it down somewhere, but I can't remember off the top of my head.
Okay, you can tell me later.
Yeah, I'd have to do the math again because I don't think I wrote it down. Wait, hold on. I might have written down on the pattern. Let me see. If I wrote down on the pattern, I'll tell you.
Doesn't say on the pattern?
Well, what it says is how many balls of yarn, so I have to math it then. Mm-hmm. And I'm not in the brain space to math. Yeah, it does say, most patterns will not just tell you so many yards. They'll say, this yarn has so many yards, yeah, and you need so many skeins.
Well, just give me the yardage and how
many you need. So, 150 yards, and you need 4 skeins. And I'm just not in a brain space.
600 yards.
Okay, so. And I had a little over 600 yards. I had, 615, mm-hmm, something like that. So I'm being very careful with my count, mm-hmm, because I don't have a lot of wiggle room. And
I wish I could remember how to do my Count of Amontillado.
Count of Amontillado?
Yeah, that yarn, because that would be pretty. Mm-hmm. I can do my one of my rooms.
Yes. But yeah, this is my way of, it's the last hurrah for a colorway I really love. That I originally picked up for a sweater. And I just feel like having it as a shawl, mm-hmm, and using every last bit of it will be just a good way to say goodbye to this colorway. Right. Although the new Dragonfly Fibers has a different colorway that looks like it's basically this colorway, but they changed the name of it. Mm-hmm. So if I really had to when I was running out, I'm sure I could do something on the edge with that one and no one would know the difference. No one would be any the wiser.
She won't know the difference. She won't know the difference.
So that finishes my projects. And Brittany just texted me. I'll take a look at that later.
Brittany.
So any graphic novel for you?
No.
That leads me on to bead and string. And I have whips and FOs for that. Well, two of the FOs
are gone.
Actually, I think they've already been delivered.
They have been.
The wedding rosaries got delivered.
Yeah, I got notifications yesterday when they delivered.
And
I got the notifications because Davina doesn't have an email address.
Yes. And I then also, on Easter, I made myself, because I wanted, for my little hip pouch, I carry a rosary in here. But sometimes, if I'm having a bad day with neuropathy or whatever, having a metal rosary in my hand actually hurts a little bit. So I made a wood one to go in my pouch as well. What's fun is one of the beads cracked, and I didn't feel like wasting another cord on a rosary for myself. So I went, and I'm trying to find the one. Oh, there it is. I put nail, held it together and put nail polish all around it multiple times, and it's holding up. Nail polish has completely fixed this bead. So you break a wood bead, nail polish that baby, and it'll stay together.
Now, she won't do that.
I won't do that for customers, but I didn't feel like doing from a rosary for myself. I didn't want to waste cord. Mm-hmm. And also, I had literally just finished it. And I was like, I'm not doing this. So I nail polished it, and it's all better now. And it's been in my pocket. It's been prayed with. It's, you know, it's holding up. So I'm happy with that little cheat that I wasn't sure was going to work. So, yeah, those are my FOs for those. And then I've got two whips for beads and string. And yours is a not needle adjacent, cord adjacent. I've got
Project adjacent.
I had to fix the rosary. I had made mom's using an old cord. And now that I have a really strong paracord, I'm remaking hers because mom's really hard on her rosaries.
I don't think it was that hard. I was just holding it and it fell apart. Although I do tend to pull.
You pull, yeah.
I don't pull on the ones as much that are in the big loop. Uh-huh. It's the three. Uh-huh. I tend to pull those.
So the paracord is a 9. I think it said it has a tensile pounds. Strength of like 90. It can handle 90 pounds.
Yeah, and I don't pull that hard.
So
I am hard on my rosaries.
I think that the paracord should be able to hold up to even mom. Mm-hmm.
Well, if it holds up to Celeste, it should hold up to me.
Well, I haven't heard any complaints yet, so we'll see. I told her she'd have to be, if she pulled that part, then she's like
Superwoman
or something. Like, she's got a secret identity I don't know about.
Wonder Woman, right?
So, yeah. Here, I have a
special. Yeah, Taya's rosary, the other rosary I have from Taya is perfect. It just.
Well, yeah. That one actually was a paracord.
Yep, that's what I'm saying.
That was with the 90-pound mm-hmm. Paracord.
That one goes everywhere. That thing is like not only a spiritual weapon, it's a physical weapon.
Well, yeah, because it's a sorry, I'm making sure I don't lose any beads.
I love that rosary.
It's a 10 millimeter. Okay, so I know I have more beads in here somewhere. Well, there's one. There's two. Oh, no, there's the third one. Okay, good. They tried to all run away. All right. This is a special order. I'm still deciding whether or not I want to redo this front area if that's too much space.
Can you say who it's for? Do I know who it's for?
No, it's an order.
An order, yeah.
So you don't know who it's for.
Okay.
So I'm hoping that's fine because I have a little space on all of them. Mm-hmm. Actually, it looks about equal, so mm-hmm. It'll be fine. So then I'll just finish up the rosary.
Looks pretty.
So this person wanted an Our Lady Undoer of Knots rosary.
Right, that's right.
So I'm finishing up their order. I just have to finish the very last bit of it. And actually, I can only hold up that rosary so long because it's a heavy rosary. Just holding it out.
That's about the size of mine?
Yeah. Yes. Actually, I almost. Someone ended up ordering, I think, the one that I made for you initially. Mm-hmm. But I almost made you and then ended up just saving it for someone else, the Undoer of Knots rosary.
Oh, okay.
Because I ended
up. The one you couldn't decide. Yeah.
I couldn't decide. And then I saw a Jesus Knocking on the Door rosary. And that, I was like, no, mom needs that one. So. Mm-hmm.
I have the images and that kind of pictures of that all over the house.
And then the other one I started on Easter. And this isn't an order. This is something I've been meaning to make Davina for a birthday gift. She doesn't like wood rosaries, otherwise I would have done this in wood. I call this Lily of the Mohawks. So this is a Kateri Tekakwitha rosary. Davina really likes Kateri Tekakwitha. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. What's interesting is one of the things that she's a patroness of, is body image mm-hmm. issues, because she was really disfigured from smallpox, and she learned to accept and live with it. And Davina does deal with some body image issues. Mm-hmm. So it's, Davina doesn't like her for that reason. She thinks she's cool. And also her Saint Box came with a cookbook, and Davina mm-hmm. loves everything to do with cookbooks. Mm-hmm. So I think that has part of the charm of it for her. But I do think that it's kind of apropos. So yeah, normally I would probably make this with, I have an option. I've now started a little book of like ideas for rosaries. And there is a form of this rosary that will have the wood beads, mm-hmm. except for the flowers and the Our right. Fathers. Mm-hmm. So I'd still say the flower of the Mohawks. I mean, the Lily of the Mohawks. Mohawks. That's, yep. That was her always her name. Or how that she was referred to for many years.
We go with the green cord too.
It would be. I chose the bright pink because well, I thought Davina would yeah. like that best.
Green and brown. I always think of her.
Me too. Yeah. And I was thinking I'm going with that sienna wood for her. Mm-hmm. They're really nice, pretty. It's like a reddy, browny.
Almost like a cedar.
Yes. I tend to prefer that kind of wood.
Me too.
That's not what I have for my rosary here, but it's only because I felt that I wanted a blue. Mm-hmm. For my cord, and I didn't feel like the sienna would look as nice with a nice blue cord, so I went with a nice turquoise for my cord and a lighter wood. But if I'd had my druthers, I probably would have gone with the sienna, but I have another rosary with the sienna. It's my Agony in the Garden one. Okay, so yes, I started these the same day as mine, but since I have a little while. I probably should get cracking on it on Sunday, though, because Davina's birthday isn't next that month. Far away.
Yeah, it's only a month away.
Not that it takes me terribly long to make one of these. Mm-mm. If I focus and have a good day. Mm-hmm. But she needs something to go in her purse, mm-hmm. because she has the big one I made for St. Demphna, but she's not lugging that huge thing. Mm-mm. Outside the house.
It almost pulls her over.
So this will be a smaller version. Like I said, she prefers metal beads. Otherwise, I would have done wood. Because I feel like it's a little bit more appropriate for the saint. Okay. That leads us on to stash enhancement.
Okay, do you have any?
Nothing that really can...
Okay, I do have some. First one is for the shop. Thank you for the people who have purchased and pre-ordered the what I call the mega worsted skeins that I have, the 440 mm-hmm. yard skeins. I'm really happy that you like those. I got one order out, one order's downstairs dry. I just have to rescan it and let the person who asked for it know. I'm excited about that. And in that same line, I had come in five skeins of this is a long sport weight. The same base as the other, the same fiber, okay? It's the same person puts it out. And this is a 700 yard skein, okay? So you could theoretically get a full shawl or something out of this. I got five of these.
How many yards?
Almost 770.
Approximately. And which weight?
Sport.
Oh, I was gonna say, if it's DK, that would cover your shawl for...
This is a long sport.
Walking...
They said it's a true sport. I'm going to see if I can open this up and see what you think. It's hard to tell when it's all...
I mean, it's hard to tell because it almost looks thin, but it's hard to tell when it's...
But this is 8 ounces, approximately 8 ounces.
Okay, well, I mean,
So, you know, trying to find the edge.
I was hot, now I'm cold.
Yeah, I've given up on having my temperature. I'm trying to find the seam on this. They really do this. I think it's right here.
Yeah, that is where it's at. See, right here you can follow it down. Awesome.
Because they really do a good job. They do each one individually.
Which is nice.
I like this because I love all my sources are good for my yarn. This particular source, if I put it in the shelf, it's not going to go all over the place because a lot of my sources put it all in one big bag. And so it goes all over the place. This one, if I just keep it in here, and it's like having a skein of yarn. So this is the size of the yarn. And they said it's a true sport.
I mean, I could use that with a fingering, I think.
I guess the best way to do is a wrap and turn. But even if it is more of a fingering weight, This is like 770 yards.
But I also tend to like a fluffy fingering weight, so mm-hmm. it could be, it's one of those ones where it's a lighter sport leading to, well, and sometimes I have trouble telling.
They said that this was a true sport, and I don't have a lot of sport yarn. I have some in stock.
I don't have anything right here with me.
When I look at it down here, it looks more like a sport yarn.
Okay, so maybe it's just my...
It might just be that was so tightly, you know, like, it's not vacuumed necessarily, yeah. but it's so tight in the bag that it might have been smushed a yeah. little bit. Because it's starting to plump up now that I have it out.
Okay.
And it's a nice yarn. And I've got five of these. And according to what it says on the website for this, it's 100% superwash merino wool, approximately 8 ounces, approximately 770 yards.
Nice.
So, all in one skein. If you're interested in this, let me know. I have five of them. And, you know, all I can say is that it's listed as a true sport, okay? A true sport weight, and it's durable but soft.
Well, you say it's pumping up, so, you know.
So that's this. If you're interested, let me know.
It did look like that bag was pretty tight.
It was. So, and my other yarn, my worsted weight ones, have pumped up after I, you know, dyed the yarn and stuff.
One of the things I want to mention that we can't show is we've had a lot of book acquisitions.
Right.
Because dear darling, lovely
Brittany. What's it doing? It says, dear darling, so-and-so, what did she say? She goes into this whole litany.
I'm not sure if I've heard it. Wait. Usually when she's trying to butter you up, like,
yes.
Most wonderful mother, she goes like all over the top. I can't remember everything she says.
Anyway, this is all for Brittany.
Yes. But yes, we have been introduced to BookBub. And now we're going to spell that for you because since we've been introduced to it, you get to be
you
as
must
well.
Be, you must be tempted as well.
So book, like as in, you know, book. And then bub, like
bub.
Wolverine says.
Yep. Hey, B-U-B. Bub.
And it's all one word. They have an app as well. And I didn't have as much success with their app. I think I just go to their website.
I go through their emails.
Yeah. And they, yeah, their emails are usually, if you wander on their site too long, it's bad.
It's bad if you wander on their emails too long. And if you look at the little, you said like one advertisement mm-hmm. on the bottom of their email. I thought, I'm getting out of here without buying something. Down at the bottom, I'm like, oh, sugar.
I usually get my BookBub email after mom gets hers, which is weird because I signed up first. Mm-hmm. But I might have more categories for them to look through mm-hmm. and parse through. Who knows? So I haven't seen mine yet today. I'll check after this. But the prices, they always have sales. You mm-hmm. say what your preferred vendor is, what your preferred format a book is, if you like Kindle, if you like paperback, mm. if you like whatever.
What authors you like, what genre
yeah.
you like.
Yeah, and then they will suggest based on the information you give.
Very bad place.
Very bad place. You would get books for like 99 cents, mm. you get free books, so
$1.99. We got a set of, I don't know how many books, for nothing.
Was that the Cozy Mystery one, or is that the...
I think that one was 99 cents.
Okay.
But still, 99 cents for like 10 books?
Yeah, there were some pretty amazing deals. And I'll be talking more about some of the things that came from that when we get to the About Us reading kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. Kind of acquisition. Has some new recipes I'm going to be trying.
Okay. I do have one more acquisition. So.
Okay, you first.
Okay. Well, no, I want to show the book a little bit. I just want to let you know in case you go.
Okay. So, I'm actually going... I have... The ingredients will be coming today. This is from... 5 dinners in 1 hour meal plans. What I like about them is they're aimed for people with families who don't have time. That's even in their live streams. That's what they're talking about. What I'm trying to make, let them know when I'm watching live streams, like, hey, you guys are actually really good for those of us with low energy, with chronic illness, because what they do is they try to use as few ingredients as possible, as many easy ingredients as possible, and the prep is supposed to be quick, easy. The cooking is supposed to be easy. Like I said, 5 dinners, 1 hour. And a lot of times they try to eliminate as many things that you can have to wash as possible. So like they'll have you put your ingredients in a Ziploc bag, zip it up and smush them all together. And that's your mixing. So if you have kids, that's a great way to get your kid involved. Here, smush this. They give you tips like have a, you know, plastic bag nearby to put your trash in. all throughout your cooking, and then take it with you to the trash can when you're done with everything. So they have a lot of good tips. They're very good for people with low energy, no time. But the two recipes that are new to me, the black bean enchilada casserole I'll be making is not new to me. That, and I always have the ingredients for that on hand. But two more, both of them slow cooker. Tomorrow, basically, I'm going to be prepping two slow cooker recipes and my black bean enchilada. I always have from them my tomato soup recipe.
Keep in mind, I'm going to leave the oven tomorrow.
The only one's oven is a black bean enchilada. That's I can wait for when you're done.
Okay.
What do you need that? Which one is it for the ham?
Ham. Mm-hmm.
Your ham doesn't take any time hardly at all.
No.
I'll prep my stuff, and when you're ready for me, I can put mine in. But if it's in the morning, you'll be doing your prayers anyway.
What?
If I do my black bean enchilada in the morning.
Oh, right.
Because my thought is, after Mass, you know, I do my food, and then I do my breakfast, and then I prep everything. Because I have two things on slow cooker. I want that running during the morning, not during the evening. But the two slow cooker recipes that sound good. Slow cooker garlic brown sugar chicken.
Daddy.
I like brown sugar. I like chicken. So I'll be decreasing the amount of garlic because my dad doesn't like garlic very much.
Well, it bothers him.
It bothers him, yes. Two of these recipes have on them that they're freezable. So they'll say like, okay, so this is a classic recipe. It's freezable. They'll say whether or not it's meatless. They'll say whether or not it's poultry. My black bean enchilada is a freezable, as is this one here. And they'll have a section for assembly, ingredients needed for assembly, and then on actual cooking day, just in case you don't cook and assemble on the same day. So like if I wanted to, when I get my ingredients today, I could assemble everything today and then just cook it all tomorrow.
Right.
The other one that sounds good, now this one is not freezable because...
Yeah, eggs.
Eggs. So it's slow cooker tater tot egg casserole. Mm. And I have tater tots from... I think another recipe I'd wanted to
make. Love tater tots.
And I still have quite a few downstairs. So you also do it in the slow cooker. So it's like I said, it's a casserole. And I'll just change out the frozen onions. Even though I have frozen onions in my freezer, Dad won't eat it if it has frozen onions. If he decides he's not going to eat it later on because he doesn't like my special cheese, I'll start putting the frozen onions in.
Yeah, because I don't mind the onions.
Yeah. But it's got Canadian bacon.
Love Canadian bacon.
I mean, I have it as a replacement. If they can't give me my Canadian bacon, it'll be ham.
Right.
But I'm trying to get the Canadian bacon.
I love
it. Is it basically the same thing?
I'm not sure what the difference is, but there is a difference.
Yeah, that's why I made an effort to get Canadian bacon.
You can get a pizza with ham or Canadian bacon.
Yeah, so I made an effort to get Canadian bacon, but like Martin's had only one option for him. Like, so I really hope they have it, because otherwise I'm putting ham in this. Because otherwise I would have just used my ham lunch meat that I had downstairs. But yeah. Oh, yeah, can't show you the recipe.
Tater tots, as a kid, I didn't buy lunch very often. My mom didn't, you know, my mom was one of those moms who made the lunch every day. Mm-hmm. So I had certain meals that I could sometimes wheedle my parents. And if I had tater tots, I would wheedle because I love tater tots. And then,
you're really looking forward to this one.
Yeah. And then I tell you some roller eyes, tuna noodle casserole.
Duh. Although I did see they had a spicy tuna noodle.
Tuna noodle?
It was a spicy tuna noodle something or other. I had to take a look at the recipe again, which looked like it might have been good. Maybe enough to spice tuna enough for me.
The other thing I really used to like was the Sloppy Joes, because we never had Sloppy Joes at home. Absolutely love Sloppy Joes.
Yeah, I don't
think
I quite get Sloppy Joes.
They're sloppy, and they're fun, and they're messy, and they're sloppy.
I mean, I don't think I... Meh.
I liked them as a kid, because we never had them at home.
Right. I mean, I've also come to realize... I don't like red meat that much. Like, I will eat it, but it's really not my preferred. I prefer chicken.
Mm-hmm.
So, I actually don't make a whole lot with red meat. Every once in a while, I'll find a recipe. Like, Dad has a, I think it's frittata or something that I have that I made that has red meat in it, and it's okay. Usually, though, chili. I prefer sausage.
My chili.
Yeah. But even then, like, if there's chili too much, I'm just, like, doing red meat.
Chili is good.
I
don't eat anybody else's chili though.
That's why I don't even look at chili recipes on sites.
And it's not anything spectacular. It's just a basic chili recipe. But I don't like a lot of stuff in it. The only time I have chili outside of the house is if I have a taco salad somewhere.
Does ham count as red meat? No.
Ham is the other white meat.
Is it the other white meat? Okay.
Yeah, I think it's the other white meat.
Because I don't mind ham. I like ham and I like sausage.
Sausage is usually. Oh, they have beef sausage, but usually it's pork.
Yeah. So, I apparently like pig and I like chicken, but I don't...
A little too pig.
But, yeah. So, looking forward to this, to prepping this, making this. With this fatigue that I've had this week, even though I've really gotten into where you make grilled sandwiches mm-hmm. on the stovetop, really enjoy that, especially with my tomato soup mm-hmm. that I get from the recipe from Five Dinners 1 Hour. Only tomato soup recipe I've found that actually works. It's also crock pot recipe, so.
Crock pots are good.
But I've had quite a few days this week where I just didn't want to make anything. I would have to force myself to
get it. I want to actually make that without, you know, when I have time to actually make it. I can't have a lot of actual dairy, so I like the Violife better because they have that provolone mm-hmm. that's smoked.
Yeah.
And that will be really good in a grilled cheese sandwich with tomato soup.
Well, I know yesterday I did 2 different cheeses in it because usually I put meat on it, mm-hmm. but yesterday's Friday, so
no,
I
yeah,
had
yesterday's Friday. Mm-hmm.
the one brand that has one brand of fake cheese that has the tomato like cayenne yeah. cheese, and then the other one was the plain white I guess it's a
white cheddar
or mozzarella that Daya does. Mm-hmm. So I did those two together. So it wasn't just the pure spice. The mm-hmm. other one kind of toned down the tomato one. And I had pickles with it as well. So I had...
Pickles have no calories.
Pickles on the side with my sandwich. And instead of the tomato soup, because I had tomato soup earlier that day, I think I had like my french fries I had made.
Right, right.
So...
I mean, who knew, right?
Yeah. So I'm really looking forward to... doing these. I've always enjoyed these recipes, and having recipes that I can freeze and then pull out mm-hmm. or have waiting in the fridge for leftovers for when I just don't feel up to doing anything more than heat something mm-hmm. up. I'm trying to get into that more, and these are the only recipes that really I can do this consistently with because they're aimed for that.
And they're good. They're
yeah.
good.
Oh, they, and it's actually fairly easy for the most part for me to make substitutions because this isn't a gluten-free, dairy-free website, but like... The black bean enchilada casserole, it has cheese in it, but I've substituted things that I can have in here. And the same thing for a couple of these other recipes. I make the tomato soup one, gosh, weekly. I always have it in my freezer. And Mom knows that she can always have some of my tomato soup. Mm-hmm. When I start running low on it, I make another one because I always like having it on hand. It's the perfect lunch.
Okay, I have one more stash enhancement. It came in, I think, yesterday. And this is the Caregiver's Companion, a Christ-centered journal to nourish your soul. So I haven't had a chance to really look through this.
Yeah, because it just came yesterday evening, too, right?
Yeah, I think in the afternoon. So it's got things like, you know, take one day at a time, reimagine stress, making decisions with faith, find peace amid stormy family dynamics, balance wishes and realities, ask and you shall receive, self-care as an antidote to compassion fatigue, speak up, find your voice as an advocate, stay engaged, keep them engaged. See the gains in the losses, build a memory bank, moving toward a holy death, move forward, more resources to nourish your mind, body, and soul. Now, I think some of this is probably for people who are dealing with terminal
and some things. Of it, like with memory, is probably dealing with people who are elderly.
Right. And it could be stuff when you're so, we have so many things going on.
Well, I mean, like, they're talking about, when they're talking about memory, like, it sounds like they're talking about creating a memory bank. I was thinking in case your family member can't remember, but I guess it could deal with
it
your own memory.
It could also deal with the person who has so much stuff going on that they, you know, need a way to remind themselves. Mm-hmm. But there are quotes in here from the Bible, and it's
Well, it looks like a pretty book.
It's a really pretty book. I will not write in this book.
Because so you can use it over and over.
I want to use a notebook, and, you know... That's, like I said, hopefully some of these sections I won't have to use for a very long time. Mm-hmm. But others...
Well, I know there's some sections in my Finding Peace Meditations for... Peace in the Storm Meditations for Chronic Pain and Illness. Some of those don't apply to me. Mm-hmm. But most of them do. So you pick out the things that do apply
right.
to you.
And they have places to write if you want to. I won't.
It's a similar format to the other mm-hmm. book by Maureen Pratt.
Mm-hmm. See? It has a fair amount of space. It's got nice, restful artwork. And it's just, you know, are you at your wit's end but not sure how to ask for help? I mean, this is, you know, it's a lot of good stuff in here, I think. So I'm looking forward to starting this.
That'll be good.
And taking my time with it.
Yeah. Well, it's kind of like the one that I was talking about, Peace in the Storm. I don't rush to do that. I generally read a chapter at a time, and then I stop.
And for those who might be interested, this is put out by Ave Maria Press.
You found it on Amazon, right?
I found it on Amazon, but it's put out by Avon.
Yeah, I think it was less expensive on Amazon.
So that was my last stash enhancement.
Okay, so then that leads us on to reading, writing, etc.
Okay, I really haven't done much in the way of writing. I've been too busy running around doing stuff, and Talia has the shared story.
I did work on.
Yay. I have done some reading, and I'm like, wow, I need to get back into some of these stories, because I'm like, why did I stop this? And then some of them I look at, and I'm like, I don't know where I was going with this. So my catalog of what I have written is ginormous.
In many ways, and I've said this many times, Mom, really, she's a lot more dedicated. Writing is more a part of who she is, at least in the fictional type of writing, than it is. She's more of a writer than I am. I write, but it's not as integral to me. I'm not constantly writing fictional things. A lot of times, I actually tend more toward the memoir-y, navel-gazing kind of stuff.
I don't write that well. I don't. I feel awkward.
Now, granted, I've done more of it since I got sick, and I have more to write about. Now, but even before that, I would write things about nursing, and, you know, just because of the kind of things I've had to experience with has given me more material.
I've never thought that my life has been all that interesting, so I turned to fiction, you know, where I can, and I like to make places, like, I don't write certain kinds of novels because I don't want to be constrained by reality. I like to create my own world. You're still constrained by the reality of that world.
But you create the rules.
But I create the rules. And so I don't have to worry about something not making sense in my world.
Part of the problem for me is I am not very good at plot. I start my characters, it's all about the characters.
And me too.
They'll just go meandering. And I'm like, oh yeah, I should probably plot at some point.
I will start writing with the one novel I finished. I started writing and thought, oh, wow, I should put an outline in here for something, I guess. And as I outlined, it took shape. But I don't like outlines. I find, at least at the beginning, I find them too constricting. I'm very much a character-driven kind of person. It takes me a lot of effort to put in context type things, like, you know, are they in a cave? Are they swimming? Are they eating dinner? No, I just want to talk, you know?
Well, then also the thing is, because we're not as we're not story driven, we're character driven, we don't plant things ahead of time. But sometimes you'll see them say, like, oh yeah, you can tell the author is planning even back at this point of the story for this to happen. We don't plan anything. Mm-mm. We're experiencing it just as the characters are.
They tell us a story, we write it down.
Right, it's almost like we're their scribes.
Yep. I mean, there are occasions when I'm like, you're not doing that. Yeah. If you try to do that, I'm not going to use you. So, you know. And yes, that sounds weird. If you write, you understand.
I will kill you, character, if you do this. I have that power.
Yes. Mwah. No, you don't. Oh, yes, I do.
You know, some of my characters pretend they don't exist.
Mm-hmm. Yep. And one of them laughs at us all the time. Doesn't believe we can do what we say we can do.
Except that then he...
Then he hedges all his bets.
Then he hedges all his bets and, like, offers chocolate
and flowers
to try to convince us not to kill off someone that he cares about.
Yes, or make someone, you know, do something that he doesn't want him to do.
So. Right. Whereas the other character is like, I don't believe in you.
Yep, you don't exist. You don't exist.
I have no evidence of your existence.
Except for the fact that he's talking to himself. Yes, we do this. This is
writers are crazy.
Yes. Do you want me to do what I've read, or do you want to do what you read?
Go ahead and do what you read. Although, I'm going to do a quick aside. It's not just us two. I was reading something that Agatha Christie wrote, where she said, and I talked to Poirot and warned him that I could write him out at any time. And he said, no, Hercule Poirot is too clever for that. So it's just an author thing. Like, she talked to
Poirot. Or even an aspiring author kind of thing. Yeah. It's just, well, you know, and they'll... You know, they plant their feet firmly and they look at you and they say, you know.
Well, by author thing, I mean, like, you write. And you get involved in it. And I don't necessarily mean published author.
Author with a capital A?
Yeah.
Yeah. So, but I did read my Daily Prayer 2021 this week because we were kind of in between our Bible studies. Mm-hmm. And I also was a little short for time. And I'm, you know, doing my Mother Teresa book and the Dragback series. I have gone into book 5 now.
Is that the last one?
There's one after that. And then Flourish that Bible study is picking up. We started that again, and it's really, really good today.
Well, I think now that we're doing it daily, it helps a lot.
Today's verse was so nice. Mm-hmm. It just hit. I mean, I do what I don't want to do. I don't understand. Anyway. So reading that and reading Jesus, the Way, the Truth, and the Life. I haven't read a lot of the other books that I have on. I do have several fiction books I picked up that I haven't put on here. There's one about a priest investigating a murder. These are fiction. And there's one about...
I think All About Father Brown.
Kind of. It's a little... It got a different feel to it, but yes. He was married before he became a priest. Mm-hmm. His wife died. In fact, her death is an unsolved murder. Mm-hmm. So there's that one. And then there's a cozy mystery, the one with the librarian who has a ghost helping her. And there's, Dragonback series. So those are my fiction books. And I also am reading Abandonment to Divine Providence, I think is what it's called, by, I think it was by Father Cassad, I think. Let me see who it was by. I might not have put it down.
I don't have it down.
So anyway, I read things and pick them up and I forget to put them down. So I'm doing a lot of reading.
I update my good reads as I go. Mm-hmm. And also I have that notebook where I write down what I read, I write down what I work on, that kind of thing. So I always have a record of it. And I usually write notes about it to myself, you know, like, oh, I don't like this, or, oh, I did this.
See, I'm reading on the treadmill most of the time, so mm-hmm. I don't have time.
Well, sometimes I'm writing about it later. Like, right before I go to bed, I usually try to make sure I've updated everything. Just because sometimes, actually, I need to go through what I've written, because some of the books I could write reviews on Goodreads based on what I read in my book. But I have finished... Okay, so I have the LibriVox app, which is free audiobooks. They're public domain. So I've listened to a version of Lady Susan that way all the way through. It was a good version. Now, they had different readers for each chapter, for each different character, and it worked out. Then finished the Sherlock Holmes, the complete collection, 2 out of 3. I'm probably not going to start 3 out of 3. Well, I did start 3 out of 3, but it's the Valley of Fear, and it is long. So I'm not sure I'm going to finish that one. I'm not that invested in the Valley of Fear.
Right. I'll be right back.
I am still reading Solace and Suffering, Wisdom from Thomas A. Kempis, Imitation of Christ. I'm also reading Jesus, the Way, the Truth, and Life by Marcelino de Ambrosio. Still reading James Alberioni, Marvel of Our Times. Another book I read only a chapter at a time is Living Memento Mori, My Journey Through Stations of the Cross by Emily M. DeArdo. Another LibriVox audiobook. Haven't finished, but I'm just mostly listening to my leisure, like when I'm making something on the stovetop, because Mom and Dad and Davina are watching a TV show that I like, but it's also, it tends to send me into a flare because it's fairly high energy and has a lot of emotional stuff to it. So I usually try to have something in my ear when I'm cooking if they're watching that, just so I don't flare myself. So I had been listening to Northanger Abbey with LibriVox. Pretty good reader for that. Still reading Flourish, which is a take-up-and-read Bible study on the Book of Romans. Oh, I forgot to grab my Mary Westmacott. I think I showed you last week that Davina got me... Oh, no, I didn't show you because I didn't have it. Well, I don't have it with me, and I don't want to leave with nobody on screen. Davina had picked up for me for Easter a Mary Westmacott series. 6 books. Like I said, I forgot to bring it with me, but it's 6 books. Mary Westmacott. Mary Westmacott was a... What is that buzz? Your phone?
My phone.
Okay. Is a nom de plume for Agatha Christie when she was not writing mysteries. I will be honest, when I started the first book, which is Giant, I felt like it was prepping for a murder. And I'm like, wow, even...
Brittany.
It just is one of those things that he's like, I can tell why she went with a different name. Because me knowing it was Agatha Christie, also I know her style very well, I kept expecting a murder. It's well written, but I don't like any of the characters. It's just they're not very likable characters. I think I like one character. And it's only because he's less deplorable than everybody else. Actually, he's not deplorable. I just, you know. He probably wouldn't be my favorite character in any of her other books. I would just be okay with him. But because he's the only likable character in this book, he's the one I like the best. Not really sure I'll continue this particular Mary Westmacott. I might skip to the next one because I'm having trouble connecting with the characters. Not because she didn't write them well, but because I just don't like them.
It's hard for us, either one of us, if we don't like a character in a book or a show, to be able to continue with that because
we're so character
because we are character driven. If I don't like anybody in it, I won't watch it.
It doesn't matter how well it's written or anything. No. We just can't. Yeah.
I can't get past the fact that I don't like anybody. I don't care.
Yeah. So. Then I started reading because I found a YouTube channel where they talk about Tolkien lore, J.R.R. Tolkien lore, talk about theories about Tolkien, that kind of thing. So I've been listening, watching that as well. And it drove me to try to read again The Silmarillion. And I'm so glad I have, because now that I have the background of enjoying Norse mythology, which I didn't have that background of when I tried to read The Silmarillion originally, I'm getting so more out of it this time. I'm enjoying it a lot more.
I have to try that again. I couldn't get through it the first time.
You have to read it with the mindset of
mythology.
It's written like the way mythology is written. It's written the way Norse mythology, any of those mythologies are written, where you don't necessarily have quotes or anything like you're reading a normal story. You're reading it just like a mythological thing, where a lot of times they say, so-and-so did this, and so-and-so did that. Now, I'm not sure when I get to the Silmarils, if it'll be a little different, but right now it's just written like Norse mythology, and you can tell that Tolkien was influenced a bit by that.
How much more do you have
to? One more book.
Okay.
Mishaps Heroes, Magic and Misrule by K.M. Merritt. Excuse me. She also goes by Kendra Merritt, but that's for her young adult books. This is her adult series. Still, there's nothing in it, but I think a young adult can just read it quite as well. And your main character is a half-orc who is a paladin, and their magic system is kind of like that in the Elenium and the Belgariad and in the Tamuli, so in David Edding's books, where it's based on a prayer system.
A faith system.
A faith system. Your magic comes from whoever your deity is. So it's not a magic system I have a problem with. I actually don't mind that magic system. And so she is trying to work against the fact that no one wants her to succeed except the one guy who's training her, and he's so good that no one can really like say no to him when he decides someone is worthy. So and then she has to pick out her own team to help her fulfill this mission of rescuing people, and they're just a complete bunch of misfits, and I love it. Her style is so fun to read, and I'm really enjoying this book. I've read about 6 chapters at a time. So I'm probably about halfway through the book. Yeah, so I'm really looking forward to seeing how that ends. She has 2 more that are
pre-ordered. Which you both have.
Which you both have. And I heard of this through BookBub. It was came up as a new release, $4.99. So this is a brand new book series. So check it out. K.M. Merritt. And Kendra Merritt's other books are ones that are reimaginings of fairy tales, but there are some disabilities involved because she was writing it or thinking about it when she was something that, I think it was, she had had some sort of surgery and she ended up paralyzed at least for a time. I can't remember I think she did recover, but she remembered thinking that she wished there was more stuff out there with people for disabilities. So she started writing it, which, hey, good for her. So, yeah. That's what I'm reading. When I get to the ones that are written as Turby and Kendra Merritt with the disabled, fairy tale princesses, I'm actually looking through them for Davina as well, because she might enjoy them.
And the reason Ty said she was sure that the young adults could read the other ones, I'm thinking that the reason she has it separate is more so that adults realize that this might be too young for them.
Okay, I see.
So, and I'm not saying they are, I'm just saying that might be the thought behind it.
Well, she wrote the other ones first.
Okay.
These are new. The ones that are her adult ones are newer.
Well, that's what I'm saying. You know, it doesn't matter which one. I'm just it separates it.
And I know a lot of people, adults, do read young adults now. Like,
I read a lot of young adults stuff because I don't want stuff.
Harry Potter is the most obvious one, but so is... Now, I don't quite agree that Hunger Games is young adult because it has some really dark themes.
But you'll find there, sometimes you'll find The Hobbit in there too.
Yeah,
I don't think I would put that in young adult.
Maybe
either.
The original Hobbit, like the first one.
Maybe, yeah.
But I think it's a bit heavy.
Yeah.
And also, I wouldn't put any of Hunger Games in there. Even though I know it's listed as a young adult, it is such a dark story. It deals with really dark themes.
I think they're thinking, you know, maybe teenagers, older teenagers and stuff.
It would have to be older teenagers because, man, it deals with some really dark themes. Whereas with Harry Potter, the kids will actually grow up with the characters. So if you start them at the age of the characters, by the time your themes might get a little darker, even though it doesn't ever get quite dark, the kids have matured to that point if they are reading them in succession of age.
And we're getting long. We need to...
Okay, I'm done.
Okay, so we want to thank everybody for joining us for the Fun in the Woman Cave. We are planning on podcasting again next weekend. Mm-hmm. Next weekend, there's nothing special happening next Friday, right?
No, not that I can think.
Okay.
Yeah, because initially... Why Friday?
I mean, the Zooms and stuff.
We don't have anything. Oh, yeah, no Zooms or anything. Yeah.
Okay, so we want to thank everybody who commented either on the YouTube or in the group. I think I responded to everybody. If I missed anybody, I apologize. It's not because I ignored you, but I didn't see you. Also, Ty and I haven't discussed this yet. I'm not sure if we're going to do Christmas and July fairies this year. If you want us to, you think we should, you know, chime in and we'll see about whether or not we want to do that.
Yeah, I guess it's kind of time period.
So they're already talking about that. So I don't know if we're going to do it, but if you think we should or you'd like to see us do that, let us know. We'll consider that, okay?
Oh, something I want to mention too. I'd already mentioned this Patreons, but this is kind of something as well. If you didn't catch the Patreon live Patreons, I'm going to be starting to do a new thing. It's called the Reenie Corner. It's for Patreons. I'm not sure what level it'll be. I think it'll probably be the highest level where I read through, we set up with tea and I read through the public domain type books. So you got Jane Austen, Sherlock Holmes, those kind of things. If I see it on LibriVox, I know I can read it. And the idea is then we can discuss it together. We can share this experience together. And I'm starting off with Lady Susan. I've actually, even though I haven't edited it yet because, you know, tripping over my tongue and stuff like that, I have recorded half the book. And I just have to record the second half and then edit through to make everything pretty. And then I'll just kind of send them out on schedules. So just so you know, that's coming for Patreons, okay. Probably for the $5 members.
Okay. I was going to say something, but I don't remember what it was. But anyway, for shops, just keep an eye on our shops because we didn't do shop news. So just keep an eye on our shop. I should be putting yarn in, hopefully. I did some yarn dyeing. I have it downstairs. I hope to do more yarn dyeing in the future here now, especially I have these new bases. And Taya is always, you know, accepting her, you know, rosary orders or if you buy her patterns or whatever. So we do want to thank the people who commented. We want to thank Barbara, Brittany, Packy Knits. Good to see you, Packy Knits.
Good to see you.
Stephanie, Allison, Meditative Crafter, Wendy, MacGyver, Andy, Sylvie, Steph, Renna, Stitched by Mimi. Good to see you too. And Lori. It's good to see all of you.
I think Emma did a comment right toward the end because I saw it come across.
Well, it's good to see all of you, but the reason I'm saying certain people is because they have been away for a while.
Yeah.
Okay.
Because we missed Emma's comment because she did just 4 hours ago.
Oh, okay.
So thank you, Emma, for your comment.
Thank you,
as
Emma.
Well.
So we hope to see you here next week for the Fun in the Woman Cave. And I can't find my clapper.
Clappy clap.
We hope to see you. We wish you a very blessed week full of whatever it is that makes you happy. I did not change the dates or episodes on this, but that's okay. We hope to see you here next week for the Fun of the Woman Cave. This is the Penhook Anita's Podcast, episode 449, and that's a wrap.
Bye.